be certain to subscribe to this channel, Deprogram Enlightener, and also my backup channel, The True Disciples of Christ, and also A Spokesman for Men. Subscribe to this ministry as we're in the last days. This is the voice of Kahan Tazadok, Deprogram Enlightener. Be certain to subscribe to Tazadok on Instagram and Facebook as well. Shalom. Most High in Christ bless.
Strength of a nation's currency is based on the strength of that nation's economy. And the American economy is by far the strongest in the world. Accordingly, I have directed the Secretary of the Treasury to take the action necessary to defend the dollar against the speculators. I have directed Secretary Connally to suspend temporarily the convertibility of the dollar into gold or other reserve assets, except in amounts and conditions determined to be in the interest of monetary stability and in the best interest of the United States.
Our story begins in 1944. With World War II coming to an end, the Allied nations met at Bretton Woods, New Hampshire, to create a new financial system which would stabilize the world once the war ended. With America poised to enter a golden age of prosperity, the U.S. dollar was chosen as the world's reserve currency.
The Bretton Woods system was created after the Second World War at the Bretton Woods Conference in New Hampshire. And rather than using gold as the means of exchange between countries, as was the case under the old gold standard, the dollar was going to be used. The dollar was chosen because back then it was as good as gold.
Under this new system, countries agreed to fix their currencies to the U.S. dollar, and the U.S. dollar would be tied to gold at a price of $35 per ounce. This meant that countries around the world could trade their currencies for U.S. dollars, which they could then exchange for gold. This created a system where all currencies were essentially backed by gold. To avoid the logistics of shipping physical gold across the world, when countries did exchange their currencies for gold, it was usually stored safely in the U.S.
Under the Bretton Woods system, you could exchange your currency or your dollars for gold. Now, it only applied to foreign countries and central banks. And we began to run budget deficits. We were running the Great Society program under Lyndon Johnson, and we were fighting a war in Vietnam. And all of a sudden, we were running these deficits, and countries were changing their dollars. And they said they wanted gold, and it began with the French, and then it started to spread.
Shabbat Shalom. Once again, it's the voice of Brother Tazadok coming at you through the spirit of Yahweh Ba'asham Yahweh Shah. For the record, I would like to reserve all of my rights according to the Bill of Rights and the Constitution of the Federal Republic. Today's date, according to their calendar, is January 21st, 2012. This is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. This is for entertainment, educational, and informational purposes only. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a lawful attorney and please be advised. Should you decide at your own free will to use any of this information that was stated herein, then you're responsible. Do not take anything that I say or anyone else says for face value. With that being said, I wanted to talk to you about this money, the money order for gold, But first, there's this guy that I know. I mean, his first name is D, and his middle initial is T, and his last name is CC. Yeah, that's him, DTCC. Now, DTCC does not want you to know about the commodity. He does not want you to know about the Commodity and the Security Exchange Act of 1933 and 1934. He wants to keep you busy with football games and basketball games and keeps you distracted by way of the media. So, now this act, there's two of them. The Security Exchange Act of 1933 and the Security Exchange Act of 1934. And under Section 12, we find that they register your birth certificate under Seed and Company. Now, when they register your birth certificate under Seed and Company, they became the registered holder. And the registered holder is actually the owner. Who's the owner in fact? You are the owner in fact. But you are the owner in fact, but you don't control anything. They control everything because they are the registered owner, registered holder, which actually makes them the holder and owner. And you control nothing. Now, we know that there's really no real money. There's a fiat currency, and there's a promissory note. Now, what exactly is a promissory note? Now, you can reference for a promissory note because many of you don't seem to believe some of the things that I put out. I mean, that's at your own free will. Many come here, you're very comical, you're living in a cartoon world. I heard someone leave a message on my page, oh, this guy's high. I don't need any type of intoxicant or external intoxicant to put me in a certain mindset. I don't abuse my temple in such matters. But nevertheless, you can continue to live in your cartoon world while I live in reality and try and wake some of these people up by entertaining them. So, a promissory note, according to UCC 9, 102, subsection 65, promissory note, it states, and you could Google this, and if you don't believe me, to look it up. A promissory, you just need to know how to research this stuff and why. Stop running around here filling out these UCC forms when you don't know what you're doing. And then coming to me and others for help. You need to learn this stuff. You need to study this stuff and learn it. And don't do any type of actions until you've actually learned this. Because many of you are going to get caught up. You're going to put yourself in a bind. It's going to be very complicated to get out of if you get out of it at war. So the promissory notes means an instrument that evidences a promise to pay a monetary obligation. Your dollar is a promissory note. Does not evidence an order to pay and does not contain an acknowledgement by a bank that the bank has received for deposit a sum of money or funds. Now, do you understand what that means? Do you understand what I just read? I'm going to read that again and I'm going to read it slow. A promissory note means an instrument that evidences a promise to pay, a monetary obligation. Does not evidence an order to pay, not an order to pay, a promise. You can pay whatever. So, and it does not contain an acknowledgement by a bank that the bank has received for deposit a sum of money or funds. So it is with your dollar bill. It's a promise to pay. Now, the money order for gold is where a lot of this madness derives from. Now, the democracy, this demonized system that a lot of you so-called black complacent Negroes just love, or you got to vote for Obama. And as I prophesized that you was going to catch hell, and now you're catching it. Many simple-minded, simplistic so-called Negroes talking about, oh, he needs more time. Man, you're damn fools. I hate to talk to you that way, but this man's not going to bring you salvation. This man is pushing the devil's agenda. I'm not going to go into that right now. So, democracy, this demonized system, on April the 5th, 1933, issue an executive order actually removing the gold from the circulation as a currency. So they replace it with this fiat currency. Now, the executive order served the same function as money to the United States people. We, the people, for actually the purchase of all the gold in the society. The gold is substance and was used as a payment for debt. Now, everybody was ordered to give in that gold, so there's no metric of payment. So many of you, you're doing the A for V, the accepted for value, and you don't understand what you're doing. And you're saying it's not working. You know why it's not working? Because you don't know how to effectively apply it, and you don't know how to word your cover letters and so on and so forth, because you don't understand what has happened. You don't understand what's going on. You're going off. So this fiat currency has been actually replaced with real money, which was the gold, which was a code. They're using this, the gold was actually used to pay debt. Now, when the president wrote the money order, a money order, because the gold was the money order was the gold. He wrote a money order, I hope you're following me, for all of the gold to be taken out of the system and placed with the government. The government actually then removed the people's ability to pay their debts. Do you follow what I'm saying to you? So, they actually removed the people's ability to pay debt because they don't have any money to pay with. So the golden rule is usually summed into he that owns the gold actually rules and tells you what to do. He that has the gold makes the rules, basically. He who has the gold pays the bills. They got the money. Your government has the money. They got the money. So, therefore, they make the payment. The government, which you so love and trust, which actually seems to have betrayed the people, the government then became in debt to who? We, the people. But you're fearing the government. The government became in debt to the people to pay all of the debts because the government is actually now holding the money. Do you understand, you people that are doing this A for B and keep getting negative results? Do you understand what's going on here? So, they are in debt to the people. Now, have you ever heard the phrase that all money is loan and exchange? Well, that's basically why, theoretically speaking. That's basically why. So, because they are actually borrowing from me. I am. Me, myself. They're borrowing from me. So the money ordered debt the people by removing the gold from our possession, which in turn credited the United States government, which is a corporation, with all of the newly held gold in their possession. Do you follow me? So this exchange is actually halfway completed because the gold was taken from the people with nothing. And the people that actually had nothing then was returned to us. They took the gold from us and they replaced nothing to us. What did they replace to us? Nothing. So the government is in debt to the people. Nothing had been returned to us at that point. So the people now need something in exchange to balance out the ledger and recredit their original holding. Now, to complete the exchange, the United States government debted themselves with a promissory note, which is why I read what a promissory note was at the beginning of this lecture. They debted themselves with a promissory note. Now, the promise of Abraham Lincoln. Those of you that think he emancipated you, or so-called freed you. Now, which in return supposedly recredits the people. This was the executive order for the president killing the legal capacity of government to control the people. The government was then deputed, epiphanetically speaking, dead. Now, the other interesting point or thing is that the debtor always has the money because he is the one that's borrowing the money. So, when the president wrote the money order, which took the gold, he became the borrower and slash debtor. And that is why there is a public debt. The people didn't create this public debt. Debt was created by government. Government. It's because they are borrowing the money from us. We, the people, the owner. Now, what must happen? What must happen now is the debt must be redeemed back to the original owner or owners. Now, here is the executive order, the money order, that the president gave. That killed the government and made them the ones liable for the debt that they associate to. So when you see the executive order, think of execute. And when you see order, think money order. Do you follow what I'm saying? Now, because the money was taken away in an executive order, which is a money order, the president is holding the money that can pay the bills. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? Are you able to actually have the insight to read between the lines? Now, here's an example. A national emergency occurs, and an executive order is issued, and money can now be sent to the victims. Another example, when Mexico or someplace like that got money from the United States, the Congress said no. But when the president, by executive order, then sent the money, it flew. Another example is when the prisons are running out of money, an executive order can be issued, and now the prisons get all of the funding that they need. And that was executive order of April 5th, 1933, under the executive order of the president, issued on April 5th, 1933, forbidding the hoarding of gold coins, gold bullions, and gold certificates. Once again, my name is Brother Tazadap. So you should know what the remedy is. Come on.
Hey, unless this is a nude loving, get the hell off my property.
You can't own property, man.
After the executive order was passed in 1933, it became illegal to own property. Marxism, the 10 planks, communism has arrived to America.
Shalom, brothers and sisters, once again, it's the voice of Brother Tazadap, coming at you through the Spirit, Most High in Christ. For the record, I would like to reserve my right. This is not legal advice. I did not offer legal advice. This is for educational, informational, and entertainment purposes only. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent attorney and please be advised. I want to speak to you today, brothers and sisters, about, are you under God, Yah, the Most High, or that which many of you refer to as God, or are you under man? Because you're going to be compelled to decide. Now, are you under the Most High? Or are you under man? It's difficult for the vast majority of us to understand that income tax did actually not exist for most individuals prior to the 1940s. Many of you can't understand that. Under man, you have over 60 million codes and statutes that you must abide by, and if you do not know them, man tells you that ignorance of the law is no excuse. Now, do you want to live under man? or do you want to live under the Most High in Christ? You're going to be compelled to decide which. You should be able to do what you want to do with your own property. Is that correct, brothers and sisters? If it's indeed your property, you should be able to do what you want to do with your property and what you want to do on your property if it's indeed your property. Whatever you want under the Most High, you have the scriptures as guidance. When you're under the Most High, He's given a scripture as a guideline to actually live by and to govern oneself by. Now, if you are actually under man, it's different. I choose to be under the Most High in Christ. And I choose to live by the guidelines of the King James 16:11 and the Tanakh. Now, if you are under man, you are actually floating in a commercial sea of commerce. There's four doors living under man. There's four doors. That's like a crossroad. You have for everything that you do when you're actually living on the sea of commerce. Everything you should do, brothers and sisters, should actually reflect the Bible. That is your guidance. That is your guideline. Everything that you do should actually reflect the laws, statutes, and commandments of the Bible. Most of you did not know that the Bible was a law book for an extremely long time. For a very long time, the Bible was a law book. So, you take away the guidance of the Most High, you're fighting. There's chaos, there's havoc. Because you're living under man. So stop fighting each other and band together as a brotherhood and live under the laws of the Heavenly Father, under our Father. For we are one in Christ. So in the Sea of Commerce, you have four doors, which is actually equivalent to a crossroad. Let me talk to you. You have acceptance, which is to agree. You have conditional acceptance. You have silent, and you have the argumentative, which means to fight. This is for every commercial presentment that is out there today. You have those four avenues of approach, of addressing it. It's all about contract. So the four doors to a claim, brothers and sisters, is silence, which is an agreement, and dishonor. That's the debtor. You have acceptance. I'm silent. You silently, when you don't answer it, you are agreeing to it. Dishonor, you're the debtor. You have acceptance, which is an agreement, the creditor. You have conditional acceptance, which is actually a counteroffer or a counterclaim. I agree if you show me proof of claim. I conditionally accept your offer upon bona fide proof of claim. And you have four, the argumentative. The argument, the dishonor, the debtor. So that is your approach to anything in commerce. Those four avenues of approach. So if you receive an offer from the court, if you remain silent and you don't respond at all, you've actually accepted the offer. You want to go to court. You don't want to appear to be afraid of these people. Gird up your loins like a man and face the system. Walk in the spirit. Mortify your members. So the judge gets you on the pirate ship. In court. And the judge asks, where do you live? What do you say? Well, I live at 96 East 100 and I live at 96 East 104th Street. I live at 301 East 77th Street, New York, New York, 10027. Brothers and sisters, you are consenting to their jurisdiction. Why not answer the question honestly? Judge asked me, where do you live? Sir, my honor, I live within the confines of this temple of the Most High. I live within the confines of the temple of my body. This is where I reside. This is my place of dwellings. It's within this temple. Brothers and sisters, you're not a name. What is a name? A name is a word. You are not a name. A name is just a word or something to use to get the attention, to get your attention. A name is used to identify a person, place, or thing, but that's not you. I'm not a name. Here, I am. Tazadok is not me. It's just a word used to get my attention. So the judge says, what's your name? I'm me. The judge said, are you Tazadok? Or you John Doe? No. Who are you? Here, I am. That is just something used to get my attention to try to create a corporate fiction to entrap me. A name is just used to get the attention. But the name is not you, brothers and sisters. Tazadok is a word used to get my attention. I can't be a Tazadok. It's a word. I'm not a word. I'm the spirit that dwells within this flesh. Here, I am. I'm me. Tazadok is not me. I'm here within this vessel, within this body. So when the judge says Tazadok, I know that that's not me. I know Tazadok is not me. I am the living soul. So the scripture says it like this, the book of Romans, the 8th chapter, verse 5. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the spirit, the things of the spirit. We are spiritual, brothers and sisters. This is not me. This is the temple in which I dwell. My address is this temple. I don't live at 207 East 96th Street, New York, New York. I don't live there. I reside within this temple. Book of Romans 8, chapter 8, verse 6. For to be carnally minded is death. So you're a dead person. The judge says, are you John Doe? You said yes. You automatically place yourself under his jurisdiction. Now you're considered to be dead. You can't speak. So they appoint an attorney to speak for you because you are dead, because you're a corporation, because you are a corporate fiction. But that's not you. Now you're letting your living soul stand in the place of that corporate fiction. Now you're on trial. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Here I am within this temple. Romans 8 and 8. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please Yah. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. Here I am, judge. Tazadok is not me. That's a name used to get my attention. I don't live at 207 East 96th Street. I reside within this temple, this body. It's the temple of the Most High. So no, I'm not that corporate fiction. I know who I am. Now who are you? Who are you, brother? Who are you, sister? Are you this corporate fiction with an address? Do you live there? Or do you live within this body? Do you live in an address? Are you a name? Are you a word? Are you a letter? Or are you a living soul? Mortify your members, brothers and sisters. But ye, Romans 8, verse 9. Romans chapter 8, verse 9. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. If so, be the spirit of Yah dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the spirit of Christ, he is none of his. So you want to walk up to the flesh, brothers and sisters. You want to be a corporation. Then you could actually stand before the wizard. Walk down the yellow brick road. And you could be that corporate fiction. Now who are you? And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin. But the spirit is life because of righteousness. So you reflect Christ. Be Christ-like. Don't walk after the flesh. You're not a name. Do you reside at that address? Or is the you that makes you you within this temple? The me that makes me me is within this temple. Therefore, the judge can't tell me or you, Tazadok. No, that's not me. No, I'm not that corporate fiction. No, I don't live at that address. I reside right within here. Do you understand what I'm saying to you, brothers and sisters? I inhabit this body, the temple of God. Once again, the name is Tazadok. Or is it Shalom?